Hello all, this is Dr. Kathleen Alsip, and I'm going to provide a quick overview of the esophagus. Recall that we dissected portions of the esophagus in the respiratory sequence. Now we're really going to review the entirety of the esophagus to provide you a scaffolding to better prepare you for the anatomy dissection experience, but more importantly, really prepare you for those clinical and basic science lectures that you'll be getting throughout the gastrointestinal sequence. So let's get started. Now, the esophagus is the proximal portion of the gastrointestinal tract, and it's going to connect the pharynx to the stomach. And conceptually, we often describe the esophagus in 3 to 4 different areas. However, it's important to note that, of course, it's continuous. So the most proximal area is what we consider the cervical portion. Then you will have the thoracic portion, that's the portion that we dissected already. And then we get to the diaphragmatic and the abdominal portion. Sometimes those are considered separately, sometimes they're considered together. The abdominal portion is really what's distal to that esophageal hiatus of the diaphragm. So remember, the diaphragm would be located right about here. So you'd have your esophageal hiatus to allow the esophagus to enter into the abdomen, and then you'd have a very short abdominal portion that will connect to the stomach. Okay, before we get into the neurovasculature of the esophagus, I want to talk about how there's different muscle associated with the esophagus, and that's quite different than what you have for the rest of the GI tract. The superior third of the esophagus is actually striated muscle, which is similar to what we had with the pharynx, and we know that all striated muscle, you're going to have somatic innervation, so that's also different than what you have from the rest of the GI tract. The inferior third of the esophagus is smooth muscle, just like you would expect with the autonomic innervation. But right around the middle portion, or the thoracic portion, you're going to have both types of muscle cells. So you'll have striated muscle as well as smooth muscle. So this is a distinction that you have in the esophagus that you won't have in the rest of the GI tract. There are 3 main constrictions in the esophagus caused by surrounding structures. You will have the cervical or the upper esophageal sphincter. This is caused by that cricopharyngeus muscle of the pharynx. You will have a thoracic or a bronchoaortic constriction. This is where that esophagus is crossed by the arch of the aorta, as well as the left main bronchus. And this is often considered a compound constriction, so a very complicated region right there. And lastly, you're going to have a diaphragmatic constriction, and this is where that esophagus is passing through the diaphragm through the esophageal hiatus. Now, why do we care about these constrictions? Awareness of these constrictions is important because when you're passing an instrument through the esophagus to the stomach, you really need to be aware of where these constrictions occur. There is a robust arterial supply associated with the esophagus, and there are various sources from very different areas. The cervical part of the esophagus is supplied by branches of the inferior thyroid artery. Remember that inferior thyroid artery is a branch of the first part of the subclavian artery. When we're talking about the thoracic part of the esophagus, this is going to be supplied by visceral branches of the thoracic aorta, such as the bronchial and obviously esophageal branches. And when we're talking about the abdominal part of the aorta, this is ultimately supplied by branches of the celiac trunk, so esophageal branches from the left gastric artery, which is one of the main branches of the celiac trunk, as well as short gastric arteries from the splenic artery, another one of the main branches of that celiac trunk. Venous drainage mostly follows the arterial supply, so that cervical part is going to drain into the inferior thyroid vein. The thoracic part is going to drain into that complex azygos system right next to the vertebral column. And the abdominal part of the esophagus is a really important site. This is a site of portal caval, and I should have an AL here, so portal caval anastomoses. Recall that portal caval anastomoses are sites where the portal venous system communicates with the systemic or the caval venous system. So the main veins draining the inferior esophageal part are the left gastric veins, which are part of the portal system, as well as the esophageal veins, which are part of the systemic or the caval system. As mentioned, there is differential innervation of the esophagus based on the muscle type. The superior portions of the esophagus, which are that striated muscle, are going to be innervated by the recurrent laryngeal nerve, which is a branch of the vagus nerve. The smooth muscle is innervated by the esophageal plexus, and it's important to note that this is continuous with the more superior cardiac and pulmonary plexuses. There are going to be both sympathetic and parasympathetic contributions. The sympathetics are mostly derived from about T4, T6, but the more inferior portions of the esophagus are going to have sources from that greater splanchnic thoracic nerve. And the parasympathetics are going to be derived from those vagal trunks, so from cranial nerve 10. This concludes the overview of the esophagus. For additional information and images, please refer to the BlueLink website.